Distinctive, uncompromising, intelligent, experimental, and original, American four-piece Tool are one of the most startling and innovative bands in the world today. Coming up to their second decade in action, their career so far has encompassed elements of heavy metal, prog, electronica, and dark psychedelia, creating a body of work that is testament to their incredible talent, undying musical integrity, and forceful imagination.
We're looking at the end times through this dark, rhythmic, powerful, freeform, conceptual kind of music.
It's like, wow, my God, these are great songs. You know, they were great from the second that they had started, you know.
The studio environment was as exciting as I'd been with any musicians. I mean, working with these guys, I realized very quickly that they were all extremely good musicians, and so that was thrilling.
They had such a strong sense of self, you know, and such a deep belief in what they were doing and the feedback they were getting from everybody, that I think it was okay for them to do something different.
In the late 1980s, the four future members of Tool all moved to Los Angeles to pursue their original ambitions. Singer Maynard James Keenan would relocate from Ohio, drummer Danny Carey from Kansas, guitarist Adam Jones from Illinois, and initial bassist Paul DeMoor from Washington. At the time, the City of Angels was ruled by a musical fad that was as far away from the challenging music Tool would eventually produce as possible. Since the mid-80s, LA had largely been dominated by glam metal, Sunset Strip rockers who valued their over-the-top theatrics as much as their musical ability. Although the scene had passed its peak by the time a new decade was beginning, it still seemed to be the prevalent force in American rock music, helped in no small part by the cultural ubiquity of superstars Guns N' Roses.
In Los Angeles in the late 80s, it was just all the mix of girl glam and some of the bands that were kind of similar to Guns N' Roses, the Junkyards and Asphalt Ballets and Trix and Circus. Just a crazy time. It was everyone wanted to be the next Motley Crue or the next Guns N' Roses.
I loved what was going on. I mean, I was right there, hair metal, thousands of people on the Sunset Strip. You know, never going home. I ate it up, but it was certainly really exciting while it was going on. You know, 17 and no rules, and like, it was just a massive, crazy party.
The late 80s and the early 90s in Los Angeles were the most loud, decadent, culture-shocking period, essentially, in rock and roll over the last two decades. You had Guns N' Roses, who'd come out of the Motley Crue, who'd come out of the area and Sunset Boulevard. You could point to this area as being the vortex of a scene of music that was being accepted far beyond the bounds of Los Angeles. Tool's early records were born out of that same musical sort of fabric, aggressive, groundbreaking sort of music, but they weren't attached to a geography.
The first inklings of the individuality and nonconformity that would come to define Tool arose through the work of another band. Born in Buffalo, Bill Manspeaker was another recent arrival to Los Angeles. His band, Green Jello, a comedy metal collective named after the food people would throw at them during gigs, had become a fixture of the Hollywood underground music scene. Expanding the number of members, they would, for a short while, recruit both future Tool pioneers Danny Carey and Maynard James Keenan. it would be a fitting early start for artists so resolutely out of the ordinary.
I was living in Buffalo, people were throwing food at me, and it was cold. And I decided, you know, I just wanted to be warm. So I had bought myself a Los Angeles newspaper, and I was going through it, you know, looking for a job, how much are apartments. And I saw this ad for this show called The Gong Show, which was a variety show, and you went on, and if they didn't like you, they hit this big gong, and you lost. And I was like, wow, this is a perfect thing for my band to be on. I could get gonged, and I could prove I'm the worst band in the world. So I got in my car, and I drove all the way to Los Angeles, and I played at the audition, and the next thing you know, I'm on the show.
Okay, let's watch this first act, and when they're finished, we're going to ask them what they did. Here's Green Jello. What you did to these people, hey, come on, up, here we go. Yeah, Green Jello. This is a terrific act. I find versatility with this. I find all kinds of great things. You've been gonged, and I really think that's what they were here for. Here, let me point you right over here. Here you go. There goes a little Green Jello. Thank you very much. Yeah, that was good. Hi, how are you? Okay, yeah.
Because I'm on the show, other people have seen it. Then I start playing these clubs. And so all of a sudden, there's this huge, like, Motley Crue, heavy metal, poofy hair scene thing that's going on. And now I'm playing at the club, being completely horrible with these big, giant costumes of farm animals like cows, pigs, chickens. People are throwing food at me saying that we suck. And it just threw off this whole, you know, heavy metal thing that was going on, because all of a sudden there was this weird thing that was disturbing it all. You know, Green Jello, what the hell is this? They suck. Oh, it's kind of funny. So, you know, we were sort of embraced by the weird metal scene because we were so freakish. Adam Jones, the guitar player for Tool, would always come and see our band. Adam was a special effects guy. He worked at Stan Winston. So one of his friends said, oh, you got to see this weird costume band. So Adam started coming around, and me and him had become friends, and we started hanging out. And Adam and Maynard were friends, and I had this big gigantic loft that we all lived in Hollywood, and Maynard just needed a place to live. He just moved into town, and I was like, yeah, sure, you know, come on over here. And he immediately joined Green Jello, and, you know, he was one of the singers. And Danny Carey was the drummer in the band, and we used to have our own parties at our studio. And, you know, one day Maynard was just tired of working at the pet store, and he said, you know what, let me make up a band for the party, and maybe I'll get signed to this $300,000 record deal.
Green Jello, later rebranded Green Jelly, would persevere with their less than serious artistic stance and would go on to see substantial success. Maynard and Danny had moved on by this point, however, and in 1990, the first incarnation of Tool had officially come together, a state of affairs which bore witness to perfect timing. A change in cultural consensus would soon mean that not fitting into the glam metal scene would be a very smart move. In the early 90s, the record-buying audience grew tired of Hairspray and histrionics and were looking for something with more substance.
Well, what do you think about interviews?
What do I think?
Really Did you hear my reaction when he asked me if I wanted to do one?
Yeah.
I said, fuck no. Yeah. I said, heck no.
An alternative rock resurgence began, spearheaded by grunge band Nirvana, whose massive success purveyed an unmistakable call to arms. It was okay to be angry, it was okay to be intelligent, and it was okay to be different. To a young group like Tool, this new American musical landscape was an open door to opportunity.
That whole thing came up. I mean, you could feel that surge of something different. And I mean, it all escalated in around end of 91 with Nirvana. I mean, that set the tone for the acceptance of those bands. Around the end of 91, it was, you were seeing bands like Fishbone and Primus. But definitely once Nirvana hit, that kind of music became more accepting, and it shut the door. I know it's cliche to say this, it's been said so many times, but it did shut the door on those Warrants and the Skid Rows and the Poisons that were definitely prevalent in 1990. And after 91, after October 91, that stuff was,
I could definitely see the importance. You know, if you're emerging and you're doing something new and, you're looking for reasons to believe in it, more than what's going on already. It was quite different. And I don't think a lot of outside forces necessarily believed in it. So I think it was probably an advantage to the people who, had sort of just moved on so rapidly. I mean, like Pearl Jam, Nirvana, like all that sort of Seattle, the grunge, I mean, couldn't be any more different than what was going on.
In the early days, Tool were compared to Nirvana because Nirvana was, of course, the big thing that was going on, the breakthrough music of the time. And Tool had some elements of loud, aggressive music and teenage angst and artistic delivery. There were certain parallels, and it was an interesting place for the band to be in. At the same time, they never really felt like they were part of that, and they never really felt like part of anything, which was really, I think, to their benefit, because they've always been able to kind of transcend what's going on around them and just kind of create their own thing while still tapping into elements of what works and what's popular and what they like.
Tool wasted no time in making a name for themselves. Gigging heavily and putting together a demo tape, it only took a couple of months for them to attract a significant following.
They recorded their first demo on a 4-track, a little cassette, handwritten. They recorded 4 songs. And, he played them for me. I was like, wow, my God, these are great songs. They were great from the second that they had started, You didn't have to lie about it, when you tell your friends, oh, it was a great song, They were really good songs. And, and I played the hell out of that cassette. I'd bring it to work and I'd play it, and everybody at work loved it. And you just had a party, and Tool played at the party at the house, We had a keg and everybody was drinking. And some of my friends from the record company came over that I knew.
They actually got the deal from the record label after playing 7 or 8 gigs because their shows were so outlandish and so different than everything else that was going on. So even if the A&R people didn't understand what they were trying to do, they knew that they were onto something different.
With the attention of record company executive Snared, Tool signed to Zoo Entertainment. And it was in March 1992 that they unveiled their debut release, an EP entitled Opiate. This short 6-song introduction to the world of the band would lay down the framework for what was to be a remarkable creative journey.
The editor of Rip Magazine, and I got invited up to Zoo Entertainment, and I was in an office. Lou Malia, he was the president of the company, and everybody at that time wanted me to hear their stuff early. And he closed his doors and he put on that Opiate. Like, this is what we got, Lon. You write about metal, your magazine's the best. And he played me that. I mean, that's early. That's before all the texture and evolution came to Tool, but you could hear.
Just kidding.
It wasn't really a full album, it was an EP, and in that respect, it wasn't your traditional EP either. They had a few studio cuts, which are songs that they'd been playing out live for a while and had been able to hone. And then they also had a couple of live songs that they decided to throw in the mix. It's interesting, I think it was Danny who told me that they weren't really confident with where they were at the time, and they really didn't want to spend a lot of money in the studio working on this material, and they knew full well that if the label gave them studio time, they were going to be responsible for paying that back in the long run. So they really wanted to get in and get out and bash out what they could and kind of move on. There's an interesting story behind that album as well that Adam told me. And he said that instead of coming out with a full-fledged debut full-length album, they decided, well, why don't we do something that's a little bit, scaled down and do an EP. And when they went to the label said, great, EP sounds perfect. But the justification for the label was that by having the band do an EP, it wouldn't count against their contract as a full album, and they'd still be obligated to do that album. So to him, that was his first indication that the record industry doesn't always have your best interest in mind.
With Opiate gathering critical acclaim, Tool further raised their profile by touring extensively with groups such as the Rollins Band and Rage Against the Machine, contemporaries who shared their no-compromise, anti-establishment veneer.
They were really taken under Henry Rollins' wing, and that's really, I think, where they made the first mark for themselves with an audience outside of the California scene. At the time, there was a nice network of kind of counterculture bands that had been signed to mainstream album labels. So, you know, there was sort of a subversion from within, and it was a good time for bands to kind of build themselves up and still have this sort of anti-establishment ethos.
Tool would also tour alongside prominent Californian alt-rock band Failure. Drummer Kelly Scott had joined Failure only 3 weeks before hitting the road with Tool and found his indoctrination into the live circuit accompanied by the most unconventional of tourmates. It would prove an eye-opening and attitude-changing experience.
It happened really quick. It was like, you know, one day I heard of this band, started playing with them, and all of a sudden we were on the road for a long extended period of time, which up until then I'd really never done. You know, I'd been, you know, all around Hollywood and stuff and done certainly, you know, tons of gigs and stuff, but nothing like that, where, you know, you have to get a passport and, you know, everyone's speaking a different language and you're seeing a bunch of stuff that you were never even really able to imagine. They're not your normal run-of-the-mill rock band of excess. There was always an underlying, like, sense of seriousness. It was refreshing, you know, because I had sort of, by that point, was starting to, the excess and the girls and the money and, you know, all those things that originally provoked me to start playing music, just kind of lost their zest, you know. That couldn't have been the only thing I was going to get out of it. And being around people finally who were really serious, you know, about the musical aspect of it, really started me asking questions, which sort of led me to believe that I had a much larger potential than just being another, like, you know, careless, irresponsible rock guy who needed to be taken care of.
This seriousness and ambition to which Tool applied themselves would come to fruition on Undertow, their 1993 debut full-length album. Heavier in sound and tone than their preceding EP, it was an interesting starting point to what would later emerge and would be overseen by former Green Jelly producer Sylvia Massey.
Hips with
Danny was very happy with working with Sylvia. I think she was able to act as an engineer and get the sound out of the band that it needed. By contrast, Adam has said that he really doesn't think that Sylvia Massey is someone who really can bring out the best in the band, in that she's not able to kind of work with their creative ideas and step outside of the box and work to create something bigger than what they sort of originally had had in mind. On its own, there are some really great songs there. You know, Sober and Prison Sex are really powerful, potent and visceral tunes that do stand the test of time, yeah.
Sober. Kind of reminds me of Kashmir, which is one of my favorite Led Zeppelin songs. Just really like hypnotic. I love when something gets you in a vibe and keeps you there. I guess when they were writing it, they didn't feel it necessary to, like, you know, take you through all these twists and turns, and, you know, it's just really simple. It's certainly one of their more straightforward songs, and it makes perfect sense why, as an introduction to a band like Tool, it caught on, and sort of like gave, I think, the people who were just being turned on to them like a nice small taste of what was to come. You know, because I imagine most of them heard the song and then went and got the record.
That album is really the closest they came to being more of a mainstream, you know, grunge slash alternative rock band. It's also the album that broke them. You know, they did extremely well with it, and it enabled them to then go on and take further steps. I think it's really a great album. But I think more than anything, it foreshadowed the greater things that were to come.
I lived under tow with Tool, you know what I mean? I know what most of those songs are about. A lot of those songs is Maynard figuring out things that have happened to him in his past, his future, and his beginning, and he sort of blurts all this stuff out, you know? They're very, like, painstaking songs for him.
People make their own choices, that's bottom line. I think, to me, it's kind of like those kind of frustrations, that kind of social frustration that comes about, people lashing out, it's because of unaddressed aggressions, repressed emotions, that kind of stuff. So to me, when you see some movie about somebody just doing some horrific deeds, in a way, by watching the movie, you have related to and expressed that emotion or that desire, and therefore you don't need to go do it. And kind of like, it's like, you know, kind of letting the steam out in a way. But the more you repress it and deny it, the more it's going to come up somewhere, and it's not going to be pretty when it happens, and it'll be real when it happens rather than just, you know, a book or story or a film or a song. So I think it's important because it doesn't, you know, we have all those nasty things that you read about or come up with or see in a film or hear about in a song. Those are in you. And if you deny that those things are in you, they're gonna bite you.
Opiate and Undertow, they're both great records, but when you compare them to the other records that they've just put out, it's almost like two different bands. You would assume that, you know, they weren't the same at all.
The most significant step in Tool's evolution to enigmatic rock icons took place in September 1995. In the lead-up to the recording of their second album, bassist Paul DeMoor left the band to be replaced with British musician Justin Chancellor.
The real watershed was the dismissal of Paul DeMoor, who was sort of holding back the sessions and preventing Tool from blossoming, I think, into a more creative, experimental, and psychedelic band. The addition of Justin Chancellor to the lineup, I think, was that ingredient that they needed, because I think he and Adam really vibed on you know, sort of experimental approach to music.
The more complex and experimental directions which Tool were branching out into would necessitate the recruitment of a new producer. The more functional stylings of Sylvia Massey were abandoned in favour of David Batrill, who by this point had worked with luminaries such as Brian Eno, Peter Gabriel, and King Crimson.
They called me up. They called up my manager in England and said they were interested in talking with me about doing work on their album. They sent me Undertow. I had never really done anything of the sort of LA metal or, you know, that kind of heavy. King Crimson was the heaviest thing I had done, but that really wasn't heavy or a metal style of music. So I kind of thought they had me confused with somebody else. And my manager had said, yeah, they're a really hot band at the moment. The only people that are going to get a look in at producing this record are people that are kind of kicking their door down. So I said, well, I like the music, but it's not really something that I know that much about. So maybe I'm kind of on their list, but way down at the bottom, and it's not going to really matter that much. So don't worry about it that much if they don't call back. Well, you know, a week later, they did call back and said, no, we know who he is, and we don't want to sound like every other LA metal band. We want to be different. So we really want to talk to him. And they detailed the records that I had done that they all listened to. Maynard was really into a lot of the world music records that I had done at Real World. Danny, again, King Crimson, real disciple of Bruford, had heard the King Crimson stuff. And Adam, his favorite record of the last 2 or 3 years, had been that David Sylvian and Robert Fripp record that I did. So they were very specific about wanting to work with me. I went over, sat in on some rehearsals, and we hit it off well. And I liked what I heard, and I thought I could contribute. So we started off the Honor record right away.
Batrill's involvement with King Crimson forged a unique creative symbiosis. Tool had long been influenced by the work of the band, and with their scope and ambition growing, this inspiration began to filter through like never before.
You can cite their inspiration musically, which was the progressive bands of the 70s, most acutely King Crimson. Tool harkens King Crimson, harkens the improvisational vibe, harkens the aggressive rhythm, and the no boundaries sort of appeal that their music has, that they're not fitting into anything.
I think Adam had listened a lot to the playing of Robert Fripp, and Danny was a real disciple of Bill Bruford's style of playing. I mean, a lot of the Simmons pads that Danny had were straight out of what Bill had started working with, and the way that they would individually write and work on their parts using the same kind of textures and the same kind of, you know, time signatures. Adam, I suppose, and the band and Tool, they write in that way. King Crimson is more, they practice a lot, and then it's improvisational throughout. So there's a difference in the style of writing. But Adam, I think, and the band kind of write in the way that Robert and King Crimson rehearse and practice. And then when King Crimson play the song, that's it. It's like it's an improvisational thing. And they usually have sections where it's all play what you like kind of thing. You know, listen to everybody else, but play what you like. And in the Tool world, it's more worked out. It's like, this is how the riff goes, and this is how we're playing it. And then, you know, there's room for improvisation a bit around it, but they work very hard on their parts and how they interlock and how they work together. So it's kind of, their writing is not, their writing process is similar. Their documentation and recording process is a little different.
Tool's King Crimson influence spread beyond the mere specifics of each band. Crimson, along with other major Tool influences such as Pink Floyd and Genesis, had long been categorized under the label of progressive rock. With their expansive and complex new studio work, Tool were making the daring move, and have been ever since, of incorporating prog elements into the relatively straightforward field of metal.
See, this is the thing about metal. We believe that it's a brotherhood where it's our music. We wear the shirts, we grow the hair, we smoke the reefer, we drink the beer, whatever stereotype you want to attach to it. We own it, it's ours. And if you're going to come into our community, you know, we have to embrace you. It's kind of a closed community. I never believed prog was a closed community. I believe prog was open. Tool, I look at as sort of a modern fusion of the 70s prog and modern metal. And then I look at Radiohead as the 70s prog and modern alternative. So that's why, to me, they're two of the most important bands in modern rock history. The fact that Maynard is this mysterious character is very consistent with his hero, Robert Fripp. That defines, to me, a real creative soul who isn't just borrowing, but putting it into their own new voice.
Well, we set the precedent right away. Our music isn't necessarily something that you just put on and tap your foot to. It's definitely more of an interactive process. So right away, the entire fan base that we've developed over the last 10 years, it's been those kind of people and kind of spread out from there. So we set the precedent initially. It wasn't about jumping up and down to some catchy phrase. It was about connecting with the music, listening, and respecting these people as artists and having and listening with an artist's ears. So, I would say the majority of our crowd are they're artists in their own way. So they have respect for what we do. They're very forgiving. They listen with their hearts rather than just show up like cattle.
It's almost postmodern. It's like apocalyptic modern, gothic modern, Hans Geiger modern, We're looking at the end times through this dark, rhythmic, powerful, freeform, conceptual kind of music.
With such influence and creative impetus spurring them on, the recording sessions for Tool's second album saw the band hitting their stride with a swagger and confidence that hadn't quite manifested in earlier work.
I had totally remember them going in the studio and recording it. And then, I went over and when they were in the studio and I listened to it and I was like, oh my God.
The studio environment was as exciting as I'd been with any musicians. I mean, working with these guys, I realized very quickly that they were all extremely good musicians. And so that was thrilling to be able to record that and to watch, the performances of that. That's my favorite part of recording is watching the great and recording the great performances. That's so much fun. Everybody had their little station. Everybody had their place where they'd set up. Justin would set up in one, booth, and Maynard was in another, and Adam was in another. But they still had great, great musical communication, and they knew their stuff. When they played it down, it was like, man, three takes, and we just had to edit between what was the greatest of the great performances and then start our overdub process. It was really nice to and painless to record, really, because they were such good musicians.
Released in October 1996, Enema was as huge a leap forward from Undertow as could be imagined and was instrumental in establishing Tool as a fully-fledged cult phenomenon.
The Enema was a breakthrough record, maybe not Tool's best record, but it was the record that really showed that they could step out of the box, take liberties with sonic experiments. Interesting industrial passages on the record, a lot of little segues that kind of create this tension and create this new sense of atmosphere.
All of a sudden they went from, aggressive 3-minute songs to these complicated, you lay down and you could see, all your problems being solved in your head by listening to the music. It went from aggressive to sexual, all of a sudden their music just engulfed not only your body, but your brain and your soul, and it made you feel positive,
One thing that's interesting about Anima is that there's a lot of use of electronics and things that they hadn't gone into before. And it also really exhibits Maynard's sense of humor, I think, especially on one track. And on this track, there's a lot of little chaotic noises and Germanic screaming. And it sounds like a really vicious track with perhaps Einstürzende Neubauten and Noy Bouton playing at a you know, at a Nazi youth rally or something. The interesting thing about that is when you find out what the lyrics are to translate the German, it's a recipe for I believe Spanish cookies or truffles or something of that respect, something completely innocuous, and it really reveals that side of the band that I think sometimes is missing. I mean, people are very tapped into the spiritual side and the enigmatic side of the band, but the sense of humor I think sometimes goes untapped.
Tool's trademark affinity for dark humor was reflected both inside and outside the Enema album. Maynard James Keenan had long been a fixture within the LA comedy performer community and would feature in programs such as HBO's Mr. Show. Also working on Mr. Show would be composer Eben Schletter, who would be responsible for one of Enema's more bizarre interludes.
I'd played around in a bunch of punk rock bands before moving to LA, and the way I ended up coming to LA was playing in comedy shows. I was in a band with Laura Milligan, and she started a comedy club, there was a club called the Diamond Club. She started a show called Tantrum that was based on a fictional character. She played a character who was a ex-child actor who had gone through rehab and was now trying to do poetry readings. And she always had this mythical asshole boyfriend, and Maynard ended up being that, playing the boyfriend later. And that's when he first heard me play organ, was at Tantrum. And because that was, I was sort of just setting up the mood for the shows with these cheesy organ renditions of Green Day, and then I'd mix it up with, like, you know, a Burl Ives children's song, and it would go from, you know, just weird Nino Rota, and Maynard's one of the people who would actually recognize, hey, he went from Little White Duck to, you know, whatever weird thing. Basically, having heard me play all this cheesy organ stuff, they were like, hey, we're working on this record. It's really long. Then they realized, given the length, they should have an intermission to break it up. And having heard me play it, Tantrum, they thought, you know, they asked me to do that. So I was like, sure. And I had no idea that it was going to end up being on this record that was so awesome. And they asked, hey, dude, fun little goofy organ intermission. Oh, that sounds like fun. And then when you see what the context is, it's just way heavier. And funny still, but heavy at the same time.
As a further and more prevalent link to underground comedy, the album itself was dedicated to infamous stand-up comedian Bill Hicks, who had died of pancreatic cancer 2 years earlier in 1994, and whose routines would be sampled on the track Third Eye.
In 1992, I was promoting a cassette I had called Wish You Were You So I Can Make Love to Me. It was a stand-up cassette. And we used to hit all the stand-up open mics in L.A., which was a place called the Natural Fudge Company. And that's where I met Maynard for the first time. And he was putting his name. And even though Tool were, you know, known in L.A., he still would go and do open mics as a stand-up because he is very influenced by Bill Hicks. And for those people who don't know who Bill Hicks was, came out of Houston, Texas, one of the outlaws of comedy, started with Sam Kinison, Brett Butler. When Brett Butler first saw him as a kid, he was 15 years old, he made most comics not even want to do comedy. Can you imagine what he was like in his late 20s? Brilliant. So Maynard James Keenan's a brilliant mind. Bill Hicks is a brilliant mind. And I think Maynard couldn't do stand-up like Bill Hicks, but he was trying, and he was trying to get his ideologies out. And I remember seeing him on stage at the Natural Fudge just kind of riffing and trying to come up with, you know, just riffing on things of the day, kind of how Bill Hicks was. But it wasn't, of course, put in a way how Bill Hicks could not only philosophize on something, but put it in to a way that manner that would be funny.
Stupid law. How many of y'all wondered like I did during the LA riots when those people were being pulled out of their trucks and beaten half to death? How many of y'all wondered like I did? Step on the fucking gas, man.
There's definitely a parallel between the music of Tool and the comedy of Bill Hicks, and it's not just them as an individual band and a comic. It's a general sensibility towards the world as an artist. With Bill Hicks and Tool, they both have that what I could say is maybe a psychedelic view of the world, a deep sort of spiritual sense, but with humor, but it can also be very dark, because a psychedelic experience is going to have a dark side to it. It's not just woo flowers. There's when a sort of truth of the world is revealed to you, it has some ugliness to it too. And both of them got that. Bill Hicks gets that, Tool gets that, and their music really reflects that. It's completely psychedelic. That's what blew me away about Enema. And that's, I think, also the jumping point between Undertow and Enema is the level of psychedelia in it. Enema's totally trippy.
See, I think drugs have done some good things for us. I really do. And if you don't believe drugs have done good things for us, do me a favor. Go home tonight, take all your albums, all your tapes, and all your CDs and burn them. Because you know what? The musicians who made all that great music that's enhanced your lives throughout the years? Real fucking high on drugs.
Bill Hicks' popularity, unfortunately, came toward before he passed away. And it all came to a head through Lollapalooza. And it was one of the last shows that they had done. He was to open up for Tool. And what he did was something Maynard would do later on in shows, is that he got up on stage and one of the bits was, "I lost my contact lens. Can you help me find it?" Funny to watch all these idiots try to find a contact lens in a fucking auditorium or 60,000 people. So Maynard actually did that later on. So you could tell he was influenced by what Bill Hicks was doing. Probably wanted to do stand-up, and I know for a fact he did because I saw him do open mics. But obviously by that time, I mean, what would you rather be, even though he didn't like rock stars, a stand-up comic where you're struggling at open mics or going in front of him playing 60,000 people? I think he picked the latter on that one. So.
Despite all these elements of comedy within Tool's aesthetic, the events of the next few years would prove anything but humorous. A legal battle began with their record label, which only found itself resolved in 1998, while in 2000 another court case was launched, this time revolving around the band's ex-manager. These trials and tribulations were proving deeply detrimental to the health of the group. A break from Tool was needed. While Adam Jones and Danny Carey went and played with respective side projects featuring the Melvins' Buzz Osborne and the Dead Kennedys' Jello Biafra, Maynard James Keenan would join a new band founded by Tool guitar tech Billy Howerdell. A Perfect Circle would surprise many by becoming a huge success in their own right.
I would have never guessed, out of all the tens of thousands of people I had met in Los Angeles that were all talented, I would never, ever expect that, first of all, he'd pull off Tool. Then he'd pull off Perfect Circle, which was completely different from Tool.
In the case of Maynard and A Perfect Circle, I think he had a lot of creative energy that he needed to expand. And they were, at the time, legally prevented from or prohibited from doing or releasing any recordings. So Maynard had things to say and needed to find another place to say them. And Billy was his roommate and guitar tech, and had started this project and approached Maynard, and he was like, yeah, if I can't say what I want to say here in Tool, then I need to go do this. He didn't expect it to do as well as it did. The first album blew up, and that really took him by surprise. And then he was faced with a situation of, okay, well, my priority still has to be Tool, but this side project has really blossomed into a successful venture that I want to tour with. So where do we go from here? And that, of course, didn't create any more, friendliness between the respective band members.
It might have provided an impetus to try and get things moving and bring that stage of their lives and careers to a conclusion so that they could then do another Tool record. A lot of people at the time said, oh, this is the harbinger of the end of Tool and everything. Well, we found that's not true. And I think with a band like Tool that have set themselves up to do these kind of, you know, spaced out recordings and albums that take a while to do and take a while to write so that there's room for, you know, people to do other things. I mean, Adams does a lot of film work, does some directing, does some things in there. Justin has interests in other areas, and Danny plays in a bunch of different things and does lots of different. So I think that, you know, they're all very, very strong individuals with a lot to say. And I think with a band like Tool or that is, again, set up to do things over long periods of time, they need to get their creativity out in other ways. And I think that it's healthy.
It was in late 2000 that Tool finally regrouped to start work on their next album. With their ambitions once more pointing towards the stratosphere, they looked back to the monumental progress with Enema and decided to work once more with David Bertrill. It would be a noticeably different experience than that of half a decade earlier.
I think the atmosphere within the band had changed. You have to remember that they had gone through an extraordinarily stressful time in between those two records. They, a lot of their core personnel, not within the band, but you know, just on the outside of the band and their support, they had to change for various reasons. And you know, there was a lot of internal stress within the band.
It is satisfying just to know that we were. Like had the strength and the courage to maintain a relationship with each other. Because I mean, it's tough. It's tough to stay married just with a person for 10 years, let alone stay married to three people, you know, for 10 years. You know, it's hard. We've had one change along the way, but it's all worked out, you know, and.
Worked out for the better.
Yeah.
That's what it was about. It was about them separating, getting distance from each other, but then all of a sudden them realizing that, you know, the pieces do fit. And actually, you know, sort of helped me personally in my life to just say, you know what, maybe it is better to work out stuff with people than it is to hold aggression towards them, because the time that you waste holding aggression towards them is time that you're losing being creative with them.
They were just better at doing the things that they were working on Anima. I think their writing was a little bit more exploratory. I think they were, again, pushing the boundaries of where they could go in the style that they were working on. I think it was kind of the pinnacle of where they were going along that path.
It wasn't so much really a five-year wait. It was, you know, we made a record, we toured on it for about 2 years. Got into some legal hassles, needed a short break. I started working with my roommate, Billy Howardell, on A Perfect Circle, and that took off way more than we thought it was gonna take off. So, I mean, you kind of have to give it, you know, its due. So we just kind of use that as our break. And that was only for like 9 months or a year. So the actual break that we took was when I was off with Perfect Circle, and then we got right back to work and record still.
We're keeping busy in our different ways, you know. We all have projects we have working on, you know. I mean,
Adam's doing nonstop art, you know, I'm always jamming with different friends and whatnot, you know, but I mean, 5 years is a while, you know, when it goes by, and I think if anything, we probably just learned a lot more about each other and how to get along and keep the band together, you know. This is a lot more than all of our contemporaries did, pretty much, who started out the same time as us. Rage, Helmet, Soundgarden, Nirvana, you know, pretty much everyone from that era is gone now except us.
We just kind of, pulled the secret maneuver that none of them really did. Like a process of communication. There's a whole band dedicated to the idea. It's called Circle Jerks. They all just got naked and worked it out.
Tool's third full-length album would be released in May 2001. Once more epic in scope, the running time being 2 seconds short of the maximum capacity for a CD, Lateralis saw Tool enter the American charts straight at number one and further stake their claim as the modern ambassadors for art-based progressive rock music.
Well, I think with Lateralis, they really wanted to take things into a much more expansive direction. There's a lot more experimentation on that record, a lot more kind of atmospheric indulgences, and certainly the progressive side of the band became a lot more more important. The singles on Lateralis are really powerful and almost encapsulate the rest of the album, because they're not, you know, pop singles per se, and Schism is a very turbulent and loud and kind of crazy song, and in some ways you hear it on the radio and you're like, what the hell is this doing, you know, on rock radio? This is so unlike anything by Nickelback or Filter or, you know, 3 Days Grace or whatever, and it's just so emblematic of who they are, and that they're able to take these left turns. They really took things out into left field and just showed how far they could stretch boundaries.
There was a definite intention to make it as full as possible. I don't know that it was a conscious decision, it's just they had all that material that they wanted to, and all those things they wanted to say. Parabola was always my favorite in that, in the world of Tool, it was kind of one of the oases of sort of normality in a way. It was sort of the least challenging or least unique song, even though sonically and within the music there was still very interesting and very, like, still more than any kind of other similar tune that somebody might write in that style.
So familiar and overwhelmingly.
There was something about that melody and the way those guitar parts and the tone of it, the way that he had the tone all rolled down, it was down in C, and it was very kind of dark and very Sabbath-y.
I think that's their most incredible album musically. Maybe not as immediate or listenable as Undertow or Anima, but if you listen with an open mind and you're willing to kind of go along for the ride, it really takes you on a journey, and I think a very powerful and spiritual one.
They wanted to make a grand statement, coming back after so much time, again, between records, and, you know, they had a lot to say. They had a lot of emotion built up that, you know, cathartically got released on that record.
One of the most remarkable aspects of Lateralis would be the cover artwork. While previous Tool albums had certainly been visually distinctive, this third release took Tool's visionary aesthetic into a league of its own. The concept, a translucent sleeve featuring various layers of the human body, would also mark the beginning of the band's creative relationship with hugely distinctive artist Alex Gray.
Adam Jones came to one of my art exhibits out in Los Angeles. He was talking about a concept for their next record album. He introduced this idea of a kind of an anatomy chart, and he knew my work, but his thinking has always been also examining the body and examining the spirit and the psyche and all these things. So we have a lot in common. And I had always wanted to do a kind of flip chart of the anatomy too, but both the body and soul. I did a few concept drawings and things for the Lateralis album. I had only gotten some lyrics from Maynard as far as the content of what the album was going to be. And I didn't hear any of the actual music, you know, until the record was released. I had been doing these flaming eyes in my artwork. And so I added some of those as the energy centers. And that was an unanticipated and fascinating little development. After the albums, the next thing he called me on was the video. It was the Parabola video. He had developed an entire concept and scenario and things like that. He's an amazing surrealist filmmaker. And so he said, I've got a minute at the end. And I wondered, you know, I have some ideas that, but we need some kind of transformation. So he invited me to participate and have my sort of directorial debut on the last minute of the Parabola. So that was very sweet of him, and he coached me along, and we made something kind of bringing some of my artwork to life.
The emergence of Lateralis and the aesthetic elements that surrounded it set in stone what is now seen as one of Tool's most defining aspects, the creation of an ongoing thematic and visual universe that few other bands could even begin to compete with.
Tool definitely has their own look and sound. It's not just, musically they have their own sound, but yeah, the visual element is very like, Nine Inch Nails is another one like that. Both those, you know, you can, with the sound off, you can see the video come on and go, hey, that's Tool. And it's not that it's all the same, it's that there's a sensibility there because it's like an artistic style. It's not a repetitive thing, it's a stylistic thing.
Adam in himself is a genius. And then when he takes it and he not only applies his music, but he applies his visual and kind of squishes it together, you know, it's like a whole new level of everything. You know, it's not, you know, I've listened to Led Zeppelin a million times and I've seen the Led Zeppelin videos a million times. It's never changed my interpretation, you know. All of a sudden, you know, a Tool video isn't about me playing guitar and me singing this song. It's about a visual and how that visual makes you feel on top of the music. That's why they're never in their own videos. They don't think that that's important at all.
With the rapturous critical response towards Lateralis, Tool's fan base and reputation as figureheads for American alternative rock would expand hugely in the 5-year interim before their next album. When work began on their new project in late 2005, the band moved on from their partnership with producer David Betrill and decided to oversee their latest recordings themselves with the help of engineer Joe Barisi.
By going with Joe Barisi, it kind of took them in another path. Their goal was to really not stagnate. They'd worked with Bottrell for 2 albums straight, so they wanted to find someone else.
I understand that people always like to move on, and I like to move on and do work with other people too. So I respect that people like to do that. If they called and asked and wanted me to do something more, sure, I'd love to work with them again. For no other reason than I love their music and I love their writing and I like them as people.
For Adam, he was very excited about working with Joe Barisi because Barisi is a very guitar-oriented producer. He vibed with a lot of where he had come from and that sort of raw direction. And wanted to see what he could work with and come out with Joe. Danny told me that he was at first very reluctant to work with Joe because Barisi was much more of a guitar producer and didn't seem, he felt, to have that kind of a gift with drumming and producing great drum sounds. Now, so he said initially working with Joe, he really kind of had to hold his hand a little bit and guide him and work with him. But he said in the end, he got some of the best drum sounds he's ever gotten on a record. So he was very, very excited about that relationship and what they were able to achieve.
The result of this new creative collaboration would emerge in May 2006. 10,000 Days was another immediate number one album, and to date marks the culmination of the imagination, creativity, and diversity that Tool have made hallmarks of during their time together.
I think 10,000 Days is a gain of growth. It's a step in a direction, and there's great songwriting on there, there's great singing. Maynard's voice is sounding better than ever. I think it's a great growth. I think it's another step along the way of their creativity as a band.
You know what? That album confuses the hell out of me. You know, I don't know where they got it. I don't know how they did it. You know, like I said, I lived right next to them, so every single day I heard them making up those songs, playing that riff, you know, 8 hours in a row, you know. I heard very scattered bits of the thing, and then all of a sudden one day, they're, okay, we're in the studio, we'll be back, and all of a sudden there were these perfect songs. And I'm like, what the? It just sounded like mishmash a little while ago. How did you get me to see the universe with this song? I don't understand. You know?
10,000 Days is a little bit harder to listen to than Lateralis. Lateralis seems to take you on a trip. That's not quite the case with 10,000 Days because the band took a couple of stabs at more straightforward rocking songs, like I think The Pot was one.
Who are you to wave your finger? You must have been out your hair. I hold deep in muddy waters. You practically raised the dead. Rob the grave to snow the cradle, then burn the evidence down. Soapbox house of cause and glass, so don't go tossing your stones around. You must have been.
A little more straightforward, a little more rock, and you know, well put together and wonderful for radio. But then you venture back out into these, you know, sort of esoteric realms again, and I'm not sure it holds together as well as Lateralis in terms of being sort of this epic construct. I think it's still a great record, and you know, at this point maybe they're incapable of making a bad record because you know, what they do is always what they want to do, and I think that's to be respected. Even if they did take these tangents, the tangents occurred because this is what they felt, you know, they were guided to do and where their inner muse was leading them.
As well as developing their musical framework, 10,000 Days would also expand on the artistic surroundings that Tool used to contextualize their work. The innovative work on display, including the album cover featuring a pair of stereoscopic lenses to view the artwork in 3D, would once more stem from the creative contributions of Alex Gray.
They're really good at that, like adding all that sort of extra stuff, which just kind of sucks you into their brain just a little bit more. I don't believe most bands are capable of doing that. I don't think most bands have that kind of vision. And I don't think most bands can come to that kind of agreement. You know, like the new records, like the goggles and all that stuff. It's like, where are you going to find four guys that will agree on doing something like that?
The word
four different people, and we all have different tastes, and it's just kind of about the chemistry of, you know, where it meets in the middle. And it's, there's enough consideration and respect about, you know, trying stuff and actually trying to excite each other in an experimental way that it's very rewarding.
Adam really art directs everything, and if he doesn't like something, then it's definitely not going to be part of a package or anything. In the 10,000 Days album, we went back and forth a little bit. He had the idea of the, you know, the stereoptoscope and the 3D thing. And so I made up a few ideas and shared them, and I don't think it was really going anywhere much. And then I said, well, why don't I just show you what I'm working on right now in the studio? And that was the Net of Being painting. We both imagined seeing it in 3D and stuff like that. And so he said, that's it, you know, got to use that somehow. They wanted to develop this booklet inside that had the 3D art in it. And so he invited me to work with a computer graphic artist that Meets Meyer, who is an amazing 3D artist, and another fellow, Bayard. So each one took a different image that I had developed. One of them was the skull fetus. I wanted to see how that looked in 3D, so Bayard worked on that. And then Meets worked on this figure that I developed called Reaching, you know. And so I presented him with a really simple sketch, and then we went back and forth and developed this into a 3D model. Since they like the Net of Being for the album, they just incorporated that. In the Vicarious video, that was, I think, the most intense collaboration, you know. Probably, except for working with my wife, probably the most intense collaboration I've ever done with any artist. And we worked very hard together. We knew that we wanted several different things. We wanted to develop this character. It became X, like the X-ray kind of character that was... and then the Net of Being was a place that that he was going to visit at some point, you know. And Adam had this notion about the destructor, this kind of thing that was ravaging the landscape. I see this, the whole arc of the video having a transformative kind of view, and in the end, because X is living on a scorched and a really desolate and alienating kind of landscape, which we could say is the, you know, what will happen to the Earth if we do nothing about the global warming and all the rest of that. I don't know that that was really at all what Adam was thinking, but this was just the kind of environment that was threatening and fascinating and dreamy that emerged as we were working together. So I don't think any of us had a real, you know, linear kind of notion of it. But in observation, this is how I interpret it now.
The success of 10,000 Days and the continual uncompromising nature of Tool's creative work has shown the band to be a remarkable anomaly in yet another way. In an age of digital downloading and increasingly fractured musical consumption, Tool remains staunch defenders of the album format as a conceptual whole. They have also retained a distinctive anti-celebrity stance, avoiding unnecessary exposure in a way that is completely at odds with the majority of other modern musical acts.
I think that's one of their strengths. I think that in music today and in the music business today, it feels to me like bands are a little bit too accessible. You know, I can't imagine Jimmy Page answering email on his MySpace page. And I think there was a certain, when I was growing up with music, and you had bands like Sabbath and Zeppelin and Aerosmith, and there was a dark mystery there. And to get too close would have destroyed it, I think. I wanted my you know, musical heroes to be inaccessible.
As far as not pandering and doing their own thing, I mean, I can't help but believe that they just found a different way to market themselves, you know? They certainly didn't intend on never selling any records. I know all those guys and, you know, just human nature. It's like, you know, you love doing something. You want to make a living doing it. Well, I think somewhere in their heart of hearts, they must have known that what they were doing and the way they were doing it and marketing themselves had just as much a chance as anything else. Or I imagine they never would have done it. They had such a strong sense of self, you know, and such a deep belief in what they were doing and the feedback they were getting from everybody. That I think it was okay for them to do something different.
I don't think any of these guys had that Sebastian Bach, Gene Simmons thing going on where I want to be a rock star. I don't think they wanted to be rock stars. I think they needed to get their poetry out of their gut. That's why they did what they did. And why they succeeded is that they were true voices. That they were given gifts.
From ear-catching 1992 EP to post-millennial status as art rock giants, the story of Tool to date remains one of the most intriguing and unique journeys the world of music has to offer. Whatever their next move, and few are willing to bet on what such an unpredictable four-piece will create next, the fans will ensure that their popularity and legacy remains deservedly one of iconoclastic acclaim.
There will be more bands that will look to that kind of model, both of writing and of running their career, and realize that that can work. And if they have the strength of their convictions, and they have the talent to write things as good as Tool or in that league, then they can be successful without having to succumb to pressure.
I can't see anyone being embarrassed because, or even nostalgic, because they say they love Tool in 20 years. You know, I think it'll be one of those bands like a Led Zeppelin or maybe like a Beatles or where it will maintain its integrity over the years.
I don't know where it's going. I just know that it is. And I'm grateful that somehow along the line, Maynard didn't pay my rent.